and welcome to another Compass Lecture Series. Today we are very honored to have Mr. Alex Filippenko here. I was in charge of giving a really quick introduction before he continues with this lecture. So real quick, he got his Bachelor's of Science in Physics from the University of California at Santa Barbara in 1979, and he got his PhD in Astronomy from Caltech in 1984 and started working here at Berkeley in 1986. He specializes in the areas of supernovas, active galaxies, black holes, gamma ray bursts, and the expansion of the universe. His accomplishments have been documented in over 650 publications, some of which have received awards. He has also been Berkeley's best professor 7 times. And his class has also been his C10 class has been one of the best classes here on campus. Various times as well. He has Mr. Filippenko has also been had a prominent role in science and newscasts and television documentaries such as Mysteries in Space and Stephen Hawking's Universe. And he is also an avid tennis player. He hikes and skis, and he loves spending time with his family. And he is obsessed with watching total solar eclipses, which I found fascinating. He's seen a total of 11 out of 11. And one quick anecdote that I find really amusing is that he realized his passion for astronomy at the age of 14 when he accidentally discovered Saturn when he was looking at the stars with the telescope that one of his parents gave him. So, Mr. Alex,
thank you very much for that very kind introduction. If you do have a chance to go see a total solar eclipse, don't miss that chance. And all of you will have a chance very soon, actually, without too much trouble. On August 21st, 2017, there's one that will crisscross from the Pacific Northwest down to the Carolinas. And so I figure everyone in the continental U.S. will be at most 1,000 or 1,200 miles from it. And many people will be within a couple of hundred miles. So if you don't go and see it, and I find out, I'll be really mad, okay? So Dan Goldsmith and I and others also, you know, travel extensively to see these things. It's a great way to see the world, by the way. So, you know, there's a lot of places you want to go. You might as well go to the place that's having a total solar eclipse first, right? And then the next place you go to is the place that has a total solar eclipse. But that's not my topic today. My topic is dark energy and the runaway universe, a topic that's very, very familiar here at Berkeley because so many of the principal investigators in this field are people here in the physics and astronomy departments or used to be here as postdocs or students, okay? So basically, you know, this is a talk about astronomy and particularly in cosmology, and we have to go back to Vesto Slipher, who in the teens of the last century noticed that most of the nearby galaxies that he could observe are moving away from us. So he looked at galaxies and passed their light through a prism or some other sort of a spectrograph and noticed that the absorption lines that are produced by stars in the spectra of those galaxies are almost invariably shifted toward the longer wavelengths, toward the better part of the spectrum. Now, the nearby Andromeda galaxy actually shows blue-shifted lines are coming toward us because it's gravitationally bound to us, but all the others are moving away. And later it was shown, this is not the classic Doppler effect, it's not due to a source moving through a pre-existing space, it's actually due to the expansion of space itself. And there are ways we can tell the difference between those two. You know, I can talk about that in the Q&A if you wish. But at that time, he didn't really know that the universe was expanding. He didn't know that space was expanding because all he really knew was that a bunch of galaxies are moving away from us. But there was no real correlation between how much they're moving away and their other observed properties. That's where Edwin Hubble comes in. He measured the distances of a bunch of galaxies whose spectra Slipher had already measured, and he found that the more nearby galaxies are moving away more slowly than the distant galaxies. So the greater the distance of a galaxy, the greater is its speed of recession. Schleifer only knew about the speeds of recession. He didn't know that there's a correlation with distance. That's why he's not credited, generally, with the discovery of the expansion of the universe. Nevertheless, Schleifer deserves way more credit than he's usually given, because usually people say that Hubble is the one who took the spectra and determined the distances. And that's simply not true. In fact, in Hubble's paper, there's not even a reference to Schleifer's spectra, which by today's standards would be considered, you know, just unacceptable, that you have to directly credit your predecessors in any place you take data or useful information from that helps you in your investigation. You've got to give credit where credit is due. But it's interesting that there's no reference to Schleifer's work in Hubble's 1929 paper announcing this correlation between distance and redshift. Yeah, just Mr. Hubble, okay? So, a nearby galaxy may have a spectrum, brightness versus wavelength, that basically is not shifted at all relative to the laboratory wavelengths of various emission lines and absorption lines. Here's neutral sodium, neutral magnesium, hydrogen, and so on, and then various emission lines. So here, the recession speed would be zero, or nearly zero. That would be the case for a nearby galaxy. But more distant galaxies, which generally appear smaller and fainter in the sky, were observed by Hubble to have bigger redshifts. So here I just conveniently took exactly the same spectrum. Of course, the spectra are never exactly the same, but I just did it to illustrate this point. I took exactly the same spectrum and shifted it toward the red by the amount that it would be shifted if the galaxy were moving away from us with a speed of a tenth of the speed of light, either because it's zipping through a pre-existing space or because of an expansion of space itself. We now know that the expansion of the universe is the latter. It's an actual expansion of space itself. Hubble actually didn't know that. In fact, Hubble even resisted the whole idea of an expanding universe. So he called these apparent recession velocities and so on. All right, so from our perspective, here we are in the Milky Way galaxy, all the other galaxies except those that are gravitationally bound to us, like Andromeda, are moving away. And at a given time, right now, the ones that are more distant are moving faster than ones that are nearby. So there's this expanding universe idea. Now, before I move on, let me pause, because there's something quite strange about this diagram as I've drawn it. What's so strange about it? Yeah, well, but in particular, around us, is I think what you mean, right? And exactly right, yes. We appear to be at the center of expansion. Is it that the other galaxies don't like us? Is it something we said? Do we smell? Are we from Stanford, perhaps? Okay, maybe that's the problem. Or maybe these other galaxies are lactose intolerant. Get it? Milky Way galaxies, lactose intolerant. I know, these are terrible. But they work well in Astro C10, okay? So I thought I'd try them on you. No, we think that this is a property of any uniformly expanding universe. And a good example is a loaf of raisin bread, where the dough is uniformly filled with yeast, and the raisins are the galaxies. By the way, the galaxies don't expand because the gravitational self-attraction is able to resist the tendency of space, empty space, to expand. But anyway, this raisin thinks it's the central one because all the others are moving away. But, you know, any other raisin thinks it's the central one as well. And don't worry about the edges here. The universe is either infinite or wraps around itself. So I'm not trying to trick you here. The other thing you can see here is that you naturally get Hubble's relationship. That is, at a given time, right now, recession speed is proportional to distance. And that's because the dough is uniformly filled with heat. So what started out being 5 centimeters away, let's say after an hour, becomes 10 centimeters away. By advanced mathematics that even a Stanford graduate can do, 10 minus 5 is 5, average speed is 5 centimeters per hour. This one started out 10 centimeters away, every bit of dough expanded, it ends up after an hour 20 centimeters away, so it moved with an average speed of 10 centimeters per hour. Every bit of dough expanded, so the greater the amount of dough between you and one other galaxy to begin with, the greater will be that galaxy's apparent speed of expansion. This Hubble law, V proportional to D, is not in and of itself any evidence whatsoever for an accelerating expansion of the universe. That will come later in the talk. This is simply evidence for a uniformly expanding universe. Okay? All right. So with the Hubble Space Telescope and other telescopes, we've now measured the Hubble constant quite well. And here is, in fact, a plot of the logarithm of the distance of a galaxy, okay, measured in some weird astronomy units called magnitudes. Don't worry about them. But they're proportional to the logarithm of the distance versus recession speed and the way this axis is drawn. That's a logarithmic axis as well. So on this log-log plot, you have this nice straight line determined using supernovae. I'll have much more to say about them later. And in fact, this is a paper that's in press with Adam Reese and me and a bunch of other people. We've measured the Hubble constant with a precision of around 3 or 4% at this point. It's 74 kilometers per second per million parsecs. Now, a parsec is about 3 1/4 light years. So the point is that V equals H naught D, the expansion rate has to be in units of kilometers per second per distance length. And then when you multiply it by some distance, that length cancels out and you get an actual speed. All right. Now, using the WMAP satellite and some assumptions, other astronomers have come up with, in a sense, a prediction of 71 or 72 kilometers per second per megaparsec. So many astronomers adopt that simply because they feel that the assumptions on which that conclusion is based, namely a flat universe, are correct. But we've always felt that we should also just measure it. And indeed, we're consistent with this microwave anisotropy probe measurement. And this is in press. There'll be a big press release in about a month or so because this is the best measurement by far of the actual expansion rate of the universe. Now, you might think that's all there is to cosmology. Once we've measured the expansion rate, there's nothing else to be done. But in fact, that's not true. This goes all the way back to Newton. You know, gravity pulls, of course. There was the proverbial apple, and it fell, probably not on his head. But basically, gravity pulls. And so, if you've got some density for the universe, some mass per unit volume, it's going to be pulled on other parts of the universe, and that should tend to retard the expansion. And if the density is high enough, then just as in the case of the Earth and the apple slows down to a stop and then comes crashing back down. All right? And so a plot of that would be that the apple is leaving my hand with a large speed. Okay, here's distance from my hand versus time, in a sense. But gravity is slowing it down so much that it brings it to a stop and then it brings it back down. That's a graph of this process right here. Okay, that's exactly what it is. So if the universe is dense enough, then in fact, the universe will stop expanding at some point and will recollapse into a big crunch, you could call it. The opposite of the Big Bang would be the Big Crunch. Or as my colleague at Harvard, Bob Kushner, told me, opposite of the Big Bang is the Gnab Gib. So you could say, Big Bang, Gnab Gib. All right? So the universe would end with a Gnab Gib if it's sufficiently dense, okay? But there's another possibility, and that is that if it's not very dense, for example, if it's empty, then there's no real reason for these galaxies to slow down and the universe will expand forever. Even if it's not quite empty, obviously the universe isn't empty, but at low density, it will still expand forever. And that's analogous to my heating the apple at a speed greater than the escape speed from the Earth. Forgetting about the ceiling here and the air resistance, it'll keep on going away from the Earth forever. It'll continue to slow down, of course, because I can't cut off the attraction of gravity between the apple and the Earth, but it's not enough to bring it to a halt. And indeed, there's a critical speed, as you know, the escape speed, 11 kilometers per second, where it just barely gets to infinity with zero speed. In a similar way, there's a critical density of the universe where it expands forever, but only just barely. And if the true density of the universe is above that critical density, well, then it'll come crashing back down on itself. If the density is below that critical density, it'll easily expand forever. If it's at the critical density, it'll expand forever just barely. And this ratio omega of the matter simply tells you the average density of the universe divided by this so-called critical density. Okay? So we want to measure omega, all right? So if the universe isn't very dense, it'll expand forever. Nevertheless, always slowing down with time. Okay? Keep that in mind. Just not enough. All right? Okay, well, so cosmologists would dearly love to know which of these possible fates the universe will have. And you can see that one way to find out would be to measure the past history. if we measure the past history and find out through measurements what curve the universe has been following, and if we believe our physics and stuff, then we can predict what it will do in the future. Now, how might you do that? Let's take a look at this part of the diagram before t equals now. The diagram is constructed in such a way that all the curves come together right now and with the same slope. Now, why is that? That's because the distance between us and some arbitrary cluster of galaxies is whatever it is right now, right? Okay? So all these curves have to come together right now because our distance from some cluster of galaxies is whatever it is. Moreover, the current rate of expansion of the universe, the Hubble constant, is whatever it is. That means the slopes of all these curves have to agree at this point. This is a point that's often not made when instructors talk about these expansion speeds of the universe. Why do we normalize here? Why don't we all start from the Big Bang? Well, we could, but then it'd be harder to understand what I'm trying to say. I've normalized all the curves so that they meet right now at a given distance between two clusters of galaxies and with a given expansion rate, 74 or 72 kilometers per second per parsec. Okay? So nearby, these guys all have the same slope. Let's go over to here now. All right? If we start looking back in time a large amount, then the slopes start differing. Okay? So let's draw t equals now right here. The scale factor, the distance between any two arbitrary clusters of galaxies, is whatever it is. Okay? That's called redshift zero. That's right now. Now, redshift z is defined in such a way. The redshift of a galaxy or a supernova or whatever is equal to the distance between us and that galaxy right now divided by what the distance was at the time that the light was emitted that we are now seeing. So redshift zero obviously corresponds to time equals now, r of t naught divided by r of t naught. But let's take a look at redshift 1. What does that mean? 1 plus 1, again, by advanced mathematics, is 2. That means that the size of the universe, or more correctly, even if in an infinite universe, the distance between two arbitrary clusters of galaxies was, at the time that the light was emitted, 1/2 of the current distance, right? Because 1/1/2 is 2. So that's what redshift 1 means. Right? So if we look at galaxies at redshift 1, then you notice a very interesting thing. And let's look at other redshifts as well, 0.9, 0.8, 0.7, whatever. Okay? You notice that depending on what the past history of the universe has been, the look-back time, how far back in time we're looking, and hence how far in distance the thing is, depends on the past history of the expansion. Because light travels at the speed of light. The distance of an object is the speed of light multiplied by the time, the look-back time, okay? So distance is in proportion to time. In the densest universe, the look-back time is the smallest. For a less dense universe, at a given distance, at a given redshift, I said that wrong, that same galaxy will be a bigger look-back time and hence a bigger distance away, okay? Even less dense universe, the same redshift corresponds to an even bigger distance. In an empty universe, you know, one which only has a couple of atoms per cubic light year or something like that, it's an even bigger distance. So you see, if we measure a galaxy at redshift 1, and we know its distance, and then we do this for a bunch of other redshifts, we can figure out which of these curves our universe has actually been following. They all converge with the same slope here and the same distance. So a low redshift galaxy has the same look-back time and hence the same distance regardless of the expansion history of the universe. So an observer's view is the following. Okay, here's the theoretical view. Here's the observer's view. Log distance versus log redshift. Regardless of the expansion history of the universe, you have a Hubble law at nearby distances, okay? That just means all these slopes are the same. All the look-back times, all the look-back distances are the same. They differ only infinitesimally regardless of what the universe has done far back in the past. That's the Hubble law, okay? At small distances. But as you go to bigger redshifts, okay, what you should have is that at bigger redshifts, the distance is smaller in the more dense universes, or bigger in the less dense universes, okay? So let's take a look at that. At a given bigger redshift, the distance is smaller in the dense universes, bigger in the less dense universes. You see that? So that's the observer's version of that theoretical diagram. These are things we can measure. Distances of galaxies, redshifts of galaxies. If we do that for galaxies over a broad range of redshifts, nearby we'll get Hubble's law regardless. But at bigger redshifts, these curves start to diverge from one another, and you can see where the points fall, and thus determine what kind of a universe we live in, and let's predict its fate. That's the idea, okay? Redshifts are easy to measure. I showed you some spectra. Distances are much harder to measure. How do we get distances, you know? How do we know this galaxy is, say, you know, 4 billion light years away rather than 3.7 or 4.3? Okay, we need to know the distance, the look-back time. Well, for nearby galaxies, the procedure is pretty easy, okay? You find a star whose properties you know. Okay, let's call that star Charlie, okay? And let's say that that star has properties, spectral properties and other properties that exactly match, or very closely match, the properties of certain stars in our own galaxy whose distance we know. So let's say we figure out that Charlie is just like Betelgeuse, a wonderfully bright red supergiant star, a very powerful star. We know how far away it is, about 640 light years. It's actually a bit uncertain, but whatever. We know its distance pretty well. Okay? We know its apparent brightness. We know the power, therefore, of Betelgeuse. If we say Charlie is exactly the same kind of star, okay, has the same intrinsic power, the same luminosity, but is very faint-looking, well, it's faint-looking because it's far away. Or maybe there's dust in the way of something, but you can rule those out. You have to do that. That's part of what being a good astronomer is all about. But in any case, if you rule out other things, it's fainter simply because of the end of its star arc. And if you do this for a bunch of stars, he's shown down and others, you know, then if you get the same answer, then you feel that you're pretty confident about the distance, the derived distance to that galaxy. So that works when you see resolved stars, like in this Hubble Space Telescope picture. You might say that's fine, but in these galaxies that are maybe 1 billion light years away, 4 billion light years away, 9 billion light years away, you know, you're not seeing any individual stars. They're too faint and they're blurred together. So the technique might not work so well at big distances. Ah, but there is a type of star that can be seen and distinguished from its neighbors, even at distances of billions of light years. What kind of a star is that? Supernova, that's right. So an exploding star that becomes much more powerful than normal stars can, in principle, be seen billions of light years away. Okay, here's supernova 87A, it occurred in the Large Magellanic Cloud, only 170,000 light years away. The better part of a lifetime ago, actually, at this point. Here's another one that went off, and you can see they brighten actually over the course of a few weeks and then fade over a number of months. But here, at its peak, it was about as brilliant as the central billion stars, normal stars in this galaxy. That's a single star going off. Oh, those guys can be seen at great distances. And if you've calibrated how powerful they really are, then you can observe how bright or faint they appear to be in a distant galaxy and use the inverse square law to figure out the distance of that distant galaxy. The trick is you've got to first calibrate how powerful they really are. And are they even uniform? Well, it turns out there are different ways in which different kinds of stars can explode. So they're not uniform, and only a certain subtype is uniform. I'll talk to you about that in a few minutes. But you first have to find and calibrate a bunch of supernovae in nearby galaxies whose distances have already been measured by measuring the brightnesses of relatively normal stars, okay? So if you find a supernova in a galaxy of known distance, measure its apparent peak brightness, that then allows you, through the inverse square law, to calibrate the luminosity, the power of that supernova. If you do that for a bunch of supernovae, you can start, you know, drawing conclusions regarding how uniform they are, and are there different types, and are certain types, uniforms, and other ones not uniform. You know, you don't want to compare apples and oranges, okay? But it's not easy to find supernovae in nearby galaxies because they're very rare. You know, a typical galaxy might produce a supernova only once every 30 or 50 years. So if I were a really cool advisor, I would have each of my students staring through the eyepiece of the telescope, preferably at night. You see more stars and galaxies at night than during the day. Running on the one galaxy, and once they find a supernova, like Isha, you know, they graduate and move on to greener pastures. Meanwhile, I will have had decades of slave labor. Now, there are some crimes that are so egregious that even a tenured professor can and should get fired, and that would be one such crime, okay? Right? Fortunately, there's power in numbers. Let's take some round numbers. One supernova per galaxy per century is statistically the same thing as one supernova per 100 galaxies per year. Each of those 100 galaxies will produce a supernova sometime in the next century. You just don't know when. But if you monitor all of them, probably one of them will do it in any given year. If you monitor 1,000 of them, frequently enough, right, you can't just look once or twice in a year, because then you'll miss it. But if you monitor 1,000 galaxies frequently enough, you'll find 10 supernovae per year. Okay? So I could have my students staring through the eyepiece of, you know, telescopes looking at thousands of galaxies, but I know that students need to study and sleep and, most importantly, party. So that would be considered cruel and unusual punishment as well, right? So, in fact, we have advanced techniques nowadays that, due to modern technology, we attach CCD cameras to the back end of telescopes, take photographs of lots and lots of galaxies in the sky, and simply look for arrows. And where you see an arrow, you see an exploding star. You see it works every time, right? Well, we stuck those arrows in with Adobe Photoshop later on. You know, we wouldn't get degrees for this kind of work if it were that easy. I have a robotic telescope that my team developed at Lick Observatory, which is just a two-hour drive from here. You should go up there sometime if you haven't been. And it's been programmed very ably by my associate, Weidong Li, to take photographs of over 1,000 galaxies in a typical night, nearly 10,000 in a week, and it compares the new pictures with the old pictures. And usually there's nothing new, but sometimes there's a candidate supernova. It's not necessarily a supernova, but it could be a cosmic ray that happened to hit the CCD, or it could be some asteroid on its way to Earth, you know, that happened to be crossing the field of view at the time. All right. So here's an example of a template image and a near image. If you digitally subtract the template from the near image, you get a few little things here. That turns out to be a cosmic ray. That's a poorly subtracted star. We have a thin mirror whose shape, unfortunately, changes with time. And here's a star near the edge of the field that didn't get subtracted well at all. But here's a thing that, in fact, looks like it could be real. And so I have a team of students who look at the candidates that the software finds each night. And out of 1,000 galaxies, maybe it'll find 50 candidates. And they'll use their superior eye-brain combination to examine those candidates and determine which objects are worthy of follow-up observations, okay? So those are the ones we study then. I should get an updated photograph. This one's nearly 3 years old. Most of these students have actually graduated and are now in grad school. He's at Stanford now, kind of an interesting guy, you know. I don't know if he's trying to get a date or what, but then I say, well, this is Berkeley, right? So anyway, he's now a grad student in engineering at Stanford, but very smart guy. We have a weekly group meeting where I supply the pizza and others in my group have to justify their existence, okay? So, anyway, we've been doing very well. In the past decade, we have been, in fact, the world's leaders in finding nearby supernovae within, you know, a few hundred million light years or something like that. And just in the last year or two, a couple of surveys have started up that are beginning to beat us. There's a thing called the Palomar Transient Factory, and, you know, if you can't beat them, join them. So I've joined them, okay? But we're still good, and we're very important. And we had a great run. For one decade, we were the undisputed world leaders in finding nearby supernovae. We found about as many as all competing groups in the world combined, in fact, okay? But now we're starting to get beaten. But that's okay, you know, more science and stuff, but we had a great run there. We found the first supernova of the new millennium, regardless of your definition of the new millennium. That's not astrophysically important, but it's kind of cool. Anyway. You might say our first supernova was of questionable integrity given its name, 1997 BS. But, you know, they're named in order in which they're discovered, from A through Z, then AA through AZ, and BA through BZ, and so on. All right. We then take spectra at the Digital Telescope, CAT, or other facilities, and we and others have found, actually this goes back nearly a century, Minkowski and Zwicky and others, that supernovae come in two broad classes. We now have a plethora of other classes. Indeed, that's why it's such an interesting field in part. But there are two broad classes, the type 1s, whose spectra don't have hydrogen. They have lots of other stuff. By the way, this is the stuff of which we are made. In case you didn't already know, you probably already do know, but we are made of star stuff, and it's really quite literally true for the heavy elements in our bodies, all right? But the type 1s don't have hydrogen, the type 2s do have hydrogen. And there are various subtypes, let me not go into that. It turns out the type 1As are the ones that are most useful for cosmology, because they're very luminous, they have billion solar luminosities, and they're reasonably uniform. Not perfectly so, but reasonably. They arise from a small kind of a star, a white dwarf, kind of like what our sun will turn into in about 7 billion years. But our sun will not expose the type 1A because it's an isolated star. It'll be below a mass limit, and there's a Chandrasekhar limit, and that'll be the end of that. It'll just cool down for almost essentially forever until proton decay or whatever, okay? But if such a star is in a binary system, it can steal material from its companion, and under certain circumstances, the mass of the white dwarf can grow to the Chandrasekhar limit, basically developed by Subramanian Chandrasekhar when he was about your age. Now, this is not to make you feel bad, but he had just graduated from his undergraduate studies in India, and he was on his way to England, where he was going to study under the great Arthur Eddington. And the voyage took a lot longer than plane rides these days, and he basically melded together the young fields of quantum physics and relativity, and stuck in some thermodynamics and statistical physics, and came up with this limiting mass for a white dwarf. And for this work, which Eddington delivered, by the way, Chandra 50 years later won the Nobel Prize, largely for this work and many other studies in astrophysics as well. Anyway, this thing reaches or gets near the Chandra limit and goes off, becomes essentially a thermonuclear runaway. And since these guys all go off at about the same mass in about the same way, they're pretty standard. And there are a couple of billion solar luminosities. Here's one of these guys. Now, they're not perfectly standard candles. Astronomers like to use this term standard candle. I don't like it because it's often applied to sepia variables. Sepias are not standard. They vary tremendously in their average luminosity, but there's a period luminosity relationship which can be used to calibrate them. So they're calibratable candles. They're not standard candles. In the same way, type 1A supernovae are not perfectly standard. They have a dispersion in their luminosity of at least 50%. Okay? But you can calibrate them. And the breakthrough was made by Mark Phillips in the early 90s when he noticed three studies of type 1As in galaxies of known distance. And hence he could assign an absolute luminosity scale. He noticed that the intrinsically more luminous type 1As rise and decline. Actually, he just measured the decline, but we now know that the rise is kind of symmetric, not quite symmetric. But anyway, they rise and decline more slowly than the average ones, and the subluminous ones rise and decline relatively quickly compared to the average ones. So it turns out then that, yes, there's a dispersion, but by measuring the light curve shape, you can remove much of the dispersion, as in the case of the famous sepia variables, which are used to determine the distances of nearby galaxies, okay? So, here's the log distance versus log speed, recession speed graph, if you assume the type 1As are all perfectly standard, but with a dispersion of whatever, 50 or 60%. Indeed, this roughly means 40 or 50% scatter, okay? Again, in these stupid magnitude units. But you can see the universe is expanding, but it's going to be hard to do cosmology when there's so much scatter. These are nearby supernovae. Distant ones, it's going to be even worse because the observational measurements will start creeping in. You know, the intrinsic scatter. But if you have calibrated this relationship using a nearby supernovae, okay, and then you apply it to a different set of nearby supernovae, that is this set, just apply the machinery. Okay? Apply the machinery which you developed through studies of a couple of dozen supernovae. Now apply that to an independent sample, this sample, and the dispersion drops by a factor of 3, from 45% to 15%. Now you can do some real cosmology, right? And not only have we taken into account the variation in the peak luminosity of supernovae, but we've also taken into account the stuff that I mentioned just briefly a few minutes ago. Dust and fog in the way can also make a supernova look fainter. And if you don't properly take that into account, you will overestimate the distance of a supernova. Just like if you don't take fog into account while you're driving, you'll overestimate the distance of a car and you might crash. Or if you don't know that that's a bicycle headlight, right, rather than a car headlight, you'll collide as well because you won't determine the distance properly. So you have to take into account both the dispersion in the intrinsic luminosity of the light bulb and the possibility that there may be obscuring junk between us and them. And that's a very, very important step. Okay, very important. Well, armed with pretty good knowledge of the Type 1As nearby, two teams, getting close to a decade ago now, formed to find and study the distant ones. My primary association was with what's called the High Redshift Supernova Search Team, and that was led by Brian Schmidt of the Australian National University, and I had a very able postdoc working with me, Adam Reese, in the mid to late 90s, and he was charged with measuring our data, with measuring the actual brightnesses of distant Type 1A supernova candidates that we had found. All right. There was another team that actually got started first. It was led by Saul Perlmutter of the Lawrence Berkeley Lab, now a joint physics appointment here as a professor in our physics department here. And I actually started out with them, but for cultural differences and stuff, I actually shifted teams, but it was after I had contributed enough to the first team that I actually was the only person to have been a co-author of both of the discovery papers that I'm going to tell you about in a few minutes, and that's why my citation rate was so high. I think it was mentioned, you know. But anyway, so I was on both teams, but primarily with this one. So it was the RZ team, it was Supernova Cosmology Project. We weren't always at each other's throats, as Saul was Brian. We would meet in Aspen, like here, you know, every once in a while to discuss our techniques. But it was really good to have two teams, because both wanted to be first, right? So with that competitive spirit, you work harder if you're looking out for number two, you know. And both wanted to be best. So if one team were taking into account various potential subtle problems and the other team were not taking them into account, then that other team would look bad by comparison. So this improved the science. Moreover, having two teams that came to the same conclusion at roughly the same time made it so that others had to believe or at least take seriously what we announced. Had there been only one team, we probably wouldn't have been taken seriously, because what I'm about to say is so bizarre. Anyway, both teams used telescopes primarily in the southern hemisphere to take wide-angle pictures of the sky. By wide-angle, I mean roughly the size of the full moon. And if you go deep enough, you see that your sky is dominated by galaxies. You quickly run out of stars in our Milky Way galaxy if you look away from the plane of our Milky Way galaxy. So if you take many such photographs over the sky in a few nights, you might get pictures of 50 to 100,000 galaxies. Repeat that process 3 weeks later, quite a few dozen, let's say, of those 50 to 100,000 galaxies will have produced a Type 1A supernova. So you know they're rare. If you don't have enough galaxies, you can find these things in batch mode. So here's an example image taken on the 7th of April, 1997, when you guys were knee-high to a grasshopper, except a few of us here in this room. And then 28th of April, 1997, subtract this one from that one, you get a bunch of noise. Any measurement process necessarily has some noise associated with it. But here, cleverly placed in the middle of the square, is something that looks like it might be real. And a Hubble picture a few weeks later confirms it, and indeed it rose and faded in a way that was similar to that of a Type 1A supernova. But to be really sure, you have to get a spectrum, and that's where my main contribution to both teams comes in. I'm a spectroscopist. I also study supernovae. Been doing that since 1985. Okay, so I get time on these telescopes to get spectra of the supernova candidates and analyze those spectra. And we would take spectra with these giant 10-meter mirrors, which are necessary to disperse the light from these very faint objects that we're trying to find in distant galaxies. I mean, they're intrinsically bright, of course, but they're very, very far away, so they look faint. So here's a spectrum of a nearby supernova, again, brightness versus wavelength. nearby supernova. There's calcium ions, silicon, iron, and other things. Here's one at redshift 0.455. This corresponds to a look-back time of about 5 billion years. So we're looking at the back when the universe was a little bit more than a third of its present, about two-thirds of its present age, about one-third back, okay? And you see that it really looks like a type 1a supernova. And moreover, you can even tell that the bumps and wiggles are sufficiently similar. And there's some differences, but that's due to noise. But they're sufficiently similar that we can even tell, these studies we've been doing the past decade, that there's not been any obvious evolution in the properties of these exploding stars over 5 billion years. I mean, there might have been. 100-watt light bulbs may have been different in the past. Maybe the Stone Age people made 92-watt light bulbs. They didn't make light bulbs at all, of course. I'm just joking here a little bit, right? But, you know, the universe evolved, so maybe the type 1As would have been different back then. But we've now been perfecting these studies, and we've shown with some confidence that there may be some differences, but they're not big enough to have affected the result that we announced in 1998. So now I'm getting to the punchline here. Here's three examples of type 1a supernovae, spectroscopically confirmed, found in distant galaxies, beautifully marked with arrows. Here's a zoom. And the punchline is that they look faint, really, really faint. You might say, well, big deal. They're in these scrawny, pathetic, distant, faint-looking galaxies. This one here, it's hard to see the galaxy at all. So obviously, they should be faint. Well, that's true. But these are fainter than they had any right to be in any well-behaved universe, okay? At a given redshift, you expect them to be a certain brightness corresponding to, well, you can derive the distance based on that brightness, okay? But what we found was the derived distance didn't correspond with that curve, didn't correspond with that curve, didn't correspond with this curve, which, by the way, at the time, 1998, this is what many other observers predicted based on other ways of trying to measure the average density of the universe. Like you measure how many clusters of galaxies there are, and you figure out how much dark matter there is with it, and then you calculate the volume in which they sit, and you can get an average density that way. Or you can measure how clusters of galaxies are pulling on one another. You know, the raisins are moving through the expanding universe because they're pulling on one another as well. And at that time, the standard model was that the universe had 30% of the critical density. Theorists wanted it to be equal to the critical density for reasons I can't go into right now because I'm running out of time. But we didn't find that the points even fell on the empty universe. Instead, we found that the derived distances based on the extreme faintness of the supernovae implied a curve that looked like this, which nominally suggests, right, if this is a magic matter greater than around 1.30, this is like a negative matter density in the universe, a repulsion. Well, no, yes and no. Yes, this is where the data fall, but no, we don't know of anything with negative mass that has a true anti-gravity in the strictest sense of the word. Right? Nevertheless, that's what the data implied, and so the headline that came out was that the sun would see a cosmic anti-gravity force at work, and we use this term hesitantly because, you know, people ask us, can we attach this stuff, whatever it is, to our cars and levitate over Bay Area traffic jams? And the answer is no. Either this stuff is a property of space, as I'll describe in a few minutes, or in which case it can't be harnessed at all, or it isn't a property of space, but there's so little of it that you really need hundreds of millions of light years, if not billions, before you see a sizable effect, okay? So, you know, we think it's in this room, but there's just not much of it in this room, okay? And I was actually privileged to be the person to announce the result for the High Redshift Supernova Search team. Now, let me mention something, because it's been an issue of controversy, and this is Berkeley and all that. Saul's team had a result that looked like this a little bit earlier, probably, than we did. But they had not yet taken into account the properties of dust and other stuff. And so, by their own admission, if you look at their poster paper, the error bars on their conclusions easily encompass an empty or a low-density universe. yes, nominally the data fell on this side of the curve, but they had huge error bars, okay? They were on their way to analyzing the data in a greater degree, but had not yet actually done so. That was January 98. In February 98, Tsai at a meeting spoke first. He showed the giant error bars. Could be something interesting, could not be something interesting, okay? And I'm saying this perfectly aware that you might watch this video. I spoke next and said, here's our results. We think we really do have something interesting. And in fact, our paper was nearly ready for submission. We submitted it for publication 2 weeks later. It was published in September of 98. They submitted their paper in September 98. It was published in June of 99. So according to the refereed literature, there's absolutely no doubt who is first. I say, let's all be friends. Let's just say it was simultaneous. That's fine. They did have an inkling of the result. They just weren't able to say that this is what we know that we found. They were wishy-washy, okay? And there's been a little bit of tension, in fact, a lot, since that time, because they often try to say, we had the result in 1998, January, and we were definitely first, and we announced it. No, they didn't. They suggested it as a possible thing, but with no conviction. We submitted it within weeks of the meeting there. And I went into this in a bit more detail than I do in public talks, just because this is Berkeley and you're Berkeley students, and I know Sol will probably win the Nobel Prize someday, and that's great, but the IG team deserves it as well, if not more so. But he deserves it as well because he started this kind of stuff. But it's the IG team that did the calibrations of dust and various weirdnesses of the Type 1A supernovae. And had we not been around, had the astronomers not been around worrying about dust and other astronomical factors, it's not clear that Type 1As would have been good enough for Sol and Gang to have been able to draw any conclusion. Okay? So again, it's good that there are two teams. We both announced it. People paid attention. And that's good. All right? That's good. All right. Well, Adam Leese was the postdoc on our team who was the first author of the paper. Later on in Time Magazine, this is from, you know, one of the up-and-coming, you know, hotshots of the universe. That was the article, basically. But Adventures in Anti-Gravity. And by the end of the year, both teams were recognized as having jointly made the most important discovery in all fields of science in the year 1998. And we were obviously very pleased by this. You might wonder, why is the caricature of Einstein surprised here? Is it because he's blowing multiple universes out of his pipe? Well, no. I mean, we actually think there may be multiple universes. Maybe Lisa Wanda will tell us about that. But we don't think they come from the pipes of famous theoretical physicists, okay? He's surprised because the one universe he blew out of his pipe is expanding faster and faster with time, not more and more slowly, and that was a big surprise. He's doubly surprised because he has a sheaf of papers here with an equation, lambda equals 8 pi g, Newton's g, times the density of the vacuum. He might say, shoot. Why did I come to Berkeley? You would say to yourself, you know, who's this bozo telling me about the density of a vacuum? You were taught on your mother's knee that the vacuum is zero, zilch, nothing. How can it have a non-zero matter or energy per unit volume? Well, again, I'm the messenger. This is Einstein speaking here, okay? Like, Einstein dreamed up an effect of unknown physical origin because at the time that he developed his general theory of relativity, it was 1917 now, nearly everyone thought that the universe was static. I mean, the universe didn't appear to be falling in on itself. The sky wasn't falling. Hubble had not yet made his discovery. Einstein thought that a static universe was an aesthetically pleasing one. On the other hand, he also knew that things follow each other, and it's beside the point that the nature of galaxies had not yet been completely discovered, but still, the sense of the argument is still the same. Gravity should be pulling on other things, and so if anything, the universe should be collapsing, okay? And so Einstein, to make a static universe, dreamed up an effect of opposite sign and equal magnitude. So, you know, if the gravity pull or if my hand dominates, then the apple moves. But if the forces are equal and opposite, and I have to tell physics majors this, the you know, within the stationary. You can have, as you all know, the same should be, may the net force be with you. Not may the force be with you. May the net force be with you, okay? So he dreamed this up. He didn't like the cosmological constant because it seemed arbitrary. There was no experimental evidence for it other than the apparently static nature of the universe. It was a mathematical fudge factor that didn't make the equations wrong. In a sense, it was a constant of integration. But the precise value of the constant of integration had to be such that it made a static universe, and there was no physical reason for that. So it was not a pretty fudge factor, and he didn't like it. He's on record of having not liked it. 12 years later, when Hubble discovered the expansion of the universe, even though at the time he didn't really want to call it that, Einstein said, well, there's no real reason for this stuff, and he was sad that he ever introduced the concept of the cosmological constant. He renounced it as having been, anecdotally, according to George Gamow, the biggest blunder of his career. Now, what have we done the better part of a century later? Both teams have resurrected the idea. And they're saying that, look, at short distances in our solar system, in our galaxy, in our cluster of galaxies, the down arrow dominates. But over a sufficiently large distance, the up arrow begins to dominate, and the net effect is one of acceleration, not deceleration. And if Einstein were around right now to hear about his idea resurrected as perhaps his greatest triumph, right, the idea that there could be such a stuff, maybe his reaction would be something like that on the cover of Science magazine. Now, just quickly, because I want to leave some time for questions, that conclusion was based on supernovae that were 4 or 5 billion light years away, okay? If this stuff is truly the cosmological constant, then there's a very clear prediction to what the universe should have been doing at some point early in its history. At some point, it should have been slowing down in its expansion. Because if you go back in time enough, the gravity between clusters of galaxies was stronger than it is now, but the anti-gravity, if you will, was weaker. Because if this stuff is a property of space, back when there wasn't much space between the clusters, there wasn't much of the push, so to speak. But there was a lot of pull. As the universe expanded, the pull decreased, that's the Inverse Square Law, the push increased because of the cumulative effect of this stuff. Okay? So you expect the early universe to have been decelerating and then eventually to start accelerating. Well, to test this idea, and this I show it right here, I forgot I had this slide, it should have been decelerating initially and then accelerating at some point. That's the idea, if this stuff really is something that's constant per unit volume with time, but the volume changes. Okay, but it's constant per unit volume with time. That's the idea of this stuff. Well, Adam Riess became the principal investigator of a project based on the Hubble Space Telescope to find and study very high redshift type 1a supernovae, at redshifts exceeding 0.6, 0.7, even 1. And the analysis showed that, indeed, these were consistent with a curve that looked like this. So the universe was decelerating initially for the first 9 billion years, and then 5 billion years ago, roughly, it started accelerating. Such a transition from deceleration to acceleration, it's obviously the derivative of the, you know, the acceleration is non-zero, and that mathematically is known as a jerk. I actually didn't know that for many, many years, but, you know, there's position, the derivative of position is velocity, derivative of that is acceleration, derivative of acceleration is a jerk. So we measured the cosmos to have gone through a jerk in its history, and then the New York Times article that came out was a cosmic jerk that reversed the universe, and here's my former postdoc, Adam Riess. You know, so people called me, hey, who's this jerk you work with who reversed the expansion of the universe? Well, he didn't do that, you know. And plus, this isn't the greatest picture of Adam. But anyway, it's kind of a funny thing. But we confirmed that whatever this stuff is, it behaves in a way that's at least roughly consistent with constant density per unit volume over all time. And now, 12 years later, that has been pretty much confirmed. That, you know, in fact, the deal is now people are trying to find deviations from the cosmological constant, because a lot of physicists don't like the cosmological constant. But we've not found any clear deviations yet. That doesn't mean this is the cosmological constant, but it still remains consistent with that hypothesis. Now, you may say, why should I believe supernovae? Okay, a bunch of teams now have come up with the same result. But maybe the technique is flawed. That's a valid concern. The more important the result in science, the more important it is to confirm it using as many independent techniques as possible. Okay? The reason this has gone from, you guys are full of it, to the standard model 12 or 13 years later is because of the confirming evidence. And I don't have much time to talk about it, but there's the Wilkinson microwave and the Huckabee probe. Probably you have had, or at some point we'll have a lecture by either Adrian Lee or Bill Holtzoff. We'll have many of the world's experts here in Berkeley on the microwave background. Indeed, George Smoot won the Nobel Prize for his studies in the microwave background. Here, a crude rendition of this map. This is the WMAP map, but Smoot had the first such map with the Kobe satellite. And basically, to make a long story short, studies of these little fluctuations in the early density of the universe, which are seen here as fluctuations in the temperature, also argue for the presence of 70% roughly of the universe being something other than what we know. And then here's a simulation of galaxy clusters and voids called the Millennium Simulation. What you do is, when you go back to... there we go. If you start with the little fluctuations in density that existed in the early universe 380,000 years after the Big Bang, I mean, they existed earlier, but this is a picture from 380,000 years, and you let them evolve through gravity, you know, the dense parts steal from the poor parts, right? It's the rich get richer, the poor get poorer. That's what gravity does, unfortunately. Anyway, you run computer simulations of the growth of structure, and you compare it with the observed structure, and this is a simulation of the observed structure. Nevertheless, it's very much like the observed structure. But you do a... here we go. No. Yeah, here we go. Yeah, yeah. Okay, so you take little fluctuations. Come on. Give it. There we go. The little fluctuations grow with time, okay, redshift is decreasing. And when you compare the computer simulations of the growth of large-scale structure with the observed large-scale structure as simulated in that Millennium Simulation, you get better agreement if you include a repulsive component to the universe than if you exclude such a component. And there are other forms of confirmation as well. So now nearly everyone agrees that this effect is real, the universe is accelerating, either because there's some weird stuff in it, or because general relativity is wrong on the largest scales. That's the other possibility. Okay. By the way, for an early history of all this stuff, you could read Dan Goldsmith's book, The Runaway Universe, from which I borrowed for the title of my talk. Let me give credit there. Don is a popular science writer with a PhD in astrophysics and can write about these things in a knowledgeable way. And a very interesting and entertaining read, only in part because I'm in it, is Don's book. So few people now disagree that the effect is real, that there's an acceleration, either because there's a new component of stuff in the universe that we hadn't recognized before, or honestly because GR might be wrong on the largest scales, okay? But let's suppose that it's because of a new component. Is it the visible matter? No, that all pulls. Is it dark matter? Right, there's dark matter there. Dark matter was dreamed up by Fritz Zwicky, one of my true heroes. He was an astrophysicist at Caltech, my graduate institution. I never met him. He died before I got there. But he was brilliant, ahead of his time in so many ways, but also arrogant and abrasive. And he didn't think much of his colleagues, and he let them know it. And so they didn't like him. Most of them, my own advisor liked him, actually, it turns out. But maybe here he's illustrating what he thinks of their typical brain size. And, you know, Caltech is a pretty brainy place, and it's full of a lot of egotistical people who did not appreciate this characterization of their intelligence by Fritz Zwicky, okay? Now, again, I don't know that that's what he's doing here, but I do know he's on record of having his colleagues spherical bastards, because, you know, they're bastards any way you look at them, right? That's not a good way to make or retain friends, okay? So, not a good way. Anyway, Fritz thought up dark matter because he saw galaxies moving around really quickly in a very famous cluster of galaxies, and he reasoned that to be moving around so quickly, there has to be additional gravity pulling on them. Otherwise, they, you know, suppose they just started out moving out that way, then this wouldn't remain a cluster for very long. These are not just galaxies passing through the night. There are lots of clusters in the sky. They're clearly gravitationally bound, and the speeds indicate that there's dark matter there. So he was really the father of dark matter, but was not recognized for this for, you know, the better part of a century, half a century almost. The Rubin in the 60s also got up by IBM and was not recognized for quite a while. But now it's the age, right? Everyone starts studies dark matter, everyone also studies dark energy. And that's the stuff that we think is accelerating the expansion of the universe. It can't be antimatter because antimatter has normal attractive gravity. So it has to be something truly new, and it's been given the name dark energy. I'm not entirely happy with it because, you know, if there's any equation your non-physics friends know, what is it? E equals mc squared. Right. So I'm continually asked, is dark energy just a different form of dark matter? Or, you know, and the answer is no. Dark energy, you know, pushes, in a sense, dark matter pulls. So it's unfortunate, but Michael Turner, a theorist in Chicago, came up with the idea, with the name. And we now know, through all these measurements, that it's important. It's three-quarters of the contents of the universe. Again, not on Earth, not on this room, not in this room, but if you average over the, you know, the vastness of space, most of which is these gigantic voids and stuff, well, they're not completely empty. They're empty of a lot of the amount of matter, but they still have this reasonably uniform dark energy. So in that sense, you know, integrated over the universe, this is the dominant stuff, and we don't know what it is. The second most dominant stuff is the dark matter, most of which we don't know what it is. We only know what some of the, what was previously called dark matter is. We actually don't even call it dark anymore. The true dark matter is the so-called non-baryonic dark matter. It's not made out of neutrons and protons. Even though some of this stuff is actually kind of hard to detect as well. So we don't know what 96% of the universe is. And in fact, there's a very recent popular book by a guy called Richard Panik called The 4% Universe. And it refers to the fact that only 4% of the universe actually consists of the stuff with which we are very familiar, okay? I actually think the book should have been called The 96% Universe, because it's about the other stuff, but whatever, that's not my book, okay? But I'm in it. So, and I don't read some Bhagavad Gita much more in Bhagavad Gita. So it's important to understand this stuff because it's so dominant. The other important aspect of it is that it may provide one of the few experimental or observational clues we have for the desired unification between quantum physics and general relativity. You know, they work wonderfully well in the domains of applicability, but when you try to bring them together, they fail completely, and they're completely at war with one another. And the problem with string theory is that, you know, there's so many versions, and there's just very few, if any, experimental tests. Well, to the degree that this might be a quantum phenomenon that manifests itself in the large-scale dynamics of the universe, you know, understanding it may help us understand or get to a theory of everything. And indeed, the theories that categorically deny the possibility of an accelerating universe can be eliminated from consideration because they don't agree with observations. And already then, dark energy has led to the elimination of some models. One idea is just that, I'm almost done too, if you need to leave, that's fine. I'm sorry I'm long-winded. But one idea is that it's this property of space. And what I mean by that is that there might be quantum fluctuations. Indeed, we know there are. They affect the properties of atoms and stuff. But physicists had always assumed that for every positive energy fluctuation, there's a negative energy one, so to speak. In string theory, it has to do with things called bosonic strings versus fermionic strings. But for a bit of, you know, in layperson's terms, which is the only terms in which I, an astrophysicist, even understand this stuff, my understanding is, you know, though they didn't know how this cancellation would occur, it should occur, just because if it doesn't occur, the magnitude of this effect should be so huge that we would not exist. Nothing would exist. The universe would have expanded too quickly. Clearly, we do exist, so they assume that this effect ends up being zero, even though it does affect atoms and Casimir effect and other things you can look up. But anyway, if there's a slight excess of positive energy fluctuations relative to negative energy ones, then you have a net energy density of the vacuum. It is a property of space, and lo and behold, it has the desired property that it actually leads to an accelerating expansion of space. So dark energy of this kind would be the trick. The problem for a fabricator is getting the right amount of excess of positive fluctuations versus negative ones. That's why theorists don't like it, okay? So other ideas are that dark energy isn't associated with a new field, correct? Because two forces were still unified at a time when they should have been separated. This generically goes by the name of quintessence. There's other variations now. There's a historical precedent. Go back to Alan Group and Andre Linde. They tried to explain certain apparently inexplicable arbitrary conditions that the universe was born with, like incredible homogeneity over life scales, incredibly flat. You know, we can't actually tell that it curves at all, kind of like living in Kansas, right? It's not, we have no real reason to think that the Earth is round, right? If you don't read books and look at the NASA pictures and stuff. Like, no, I'm just saying it's not the bad one, but if you're completely isolated from the world in Kansas, it's not a bad conclusion to conclude that the Earth is flat, right? So in a similar way, you know, there were these arbitrary things, you know, that, but they explained them by saying that the Big Bang, in a sense, was an enormously rapid exponential growth of the universe in the first something like trillionth of a trillionth of a trillionth of a second. But then that expansion stopped. I mean, it was the launching of the apple, that was inflation, but then the exponentiation stopped because whatever was causing it turned into something that was gravitationally attractive. Okay, and that's the idea. The universe was inflated by something that was like dark energy qualitatively, but most definitely not the cosmological constant, because the cosmological constant never goes away. And this stuff, we think, decayed into the stuff of which we are made. You inflated the universe. You helped inflate it, okay? Kudos to you. Anyway, so this is a historical precedent for these quintessence ideas that attribute the current acceleration not to the cosmological constant, but to something else. So anyway, it's a cool thing. Maybe you guys will figure out what this is, and then you'll get a Nobel Prize for sure, if people believe you. But here is the history of the universe. There was a quantum fluctuation, maybe from which the universe was born, or maybe it budded off from some other universe. Then there were real quantum fluctuations within the universe that then got inflated to a big size, and that's really what the microwave background is showing us. Then that exponentiation stopped. That was, I like to think of that as that was the bang in the Big Bang. Before that, there was just a little tiny bit of stuff, you know, that was maybe expanding and cooling, but all right, you can call that the Big Bang too. Physicists disagree on what they actually call the Big Bang, but to me, inflation was the bang. And then it stopped, but the universe kept coasting, okay, and it decelerated for 9 billion years, okay? After the first split second. It decelerated for 9 billion years, but then as this leftover stuff, or whatever the dark energy is, started dominating over gravity, 5 billion years ago, it started accelerating again. And here's WMAP satellite, because this was made by their team, so of course they accentuate, they emphasize the WMAP. Brilliant, you know, thing. But, you know, they didn't discover this, and there's a bit of revisionist history sometimes. Sometimes the microwave background people are the ones who say that, well, they discovered the dark energy. Well, the rationale is, in around the year 2000, even a little bit before that, they had a pretty good idea that the universe was flat. That requires this omega thing to be one. Measurements of the matter of the universe gave values of 0.3. Subtraction gives you 0.7 of something else. But yes, in retrospect, yeah, that's an argument, but few, if any, of them were pushing it back then, right, Don? And yet sometimes today they claim that the microwave background is what led to the discovery of this, and it's just not true, okay? So anyway, so how will the universe end? Well, if the dark energy continues to be repulsive, then the universe will expand forever, faster and faster and faster, a runaway universe. Okay? So if you want to see clusters of galaxies through a telescope with your very own eyes, you better do so in the next few tens of billions of years, because after that time, the galaxies will have been whisked away beyond detection, beyond detectability. But there's another possibility, and that is that since we don't know what the dark energy is, and back in the year 2001 when they wrote the cover story about our work, this looks like a statement, how the universe will end. Well, Andre Linde and others pointed out that there are theories or models of dark energy where the sign changes after a while, as it did in the early inflation of the universe. The sign went from being repulsive to being attractive. Okay? So there's, again, a historical precedent. So if today's dark energy is something similar to what inflated the universe to begin with, then it could decay in the future and become gravitationally attractive, in which case, if omega is slightly bigger than 1, then the universe will someday, you know, come to a halt and reverse itself and end in the mad dip, ending in fire, hot and compressed. But at least for now, it's accelerating its expansion, you know. But what it'll do in the future, who knows? Anyway, Robert Frost probably didn't know about the cosmological constant and the acceleration of the universe, but he at least was sufficiently well-educated to know that the universe could either end in fire, the big crunch, or eternal expansion, becoming ever darker, colder, more dilute, in a sense, and ending in ice, right? Because he had this poem, Fire and Ice. Some say the world will end in fire. Some say in ice. From what I've known of desire, I hold with those who favor fire. But if it had to perish twice, I think I know enough of hate to say that for destruction, ice is also great and would suffice. So, Frost would prefer that big crunch universe, but if the universe and he had to perish twice, then eternal expansion and an ending in ice would be okay with him. And that's perhaps appropriate given his name, Robert Frost. Thank you very much. And I can stick around for a few minutes for questions. I'm sorry I was a bit long-winded. As I said, I wanted to give you guys more of the physics than I do in a normal, public talk. But I didn't want to leave out the things that I include in the public talk, too. So. Okay, yes. How do we know that the galaxies are moving, you know, that space is expanding? The theorists would say, first of all, the whole theoretical framework of general relativity dictates that. It turns out that there's no real way to understand the universe unless it's that way. However, that's just theory. The observational test is the following. There's a thing that you can even look up called the Tolman, T-O-L-M-A-N, surface brightness test. And that is that the surface brightness, the brightness per unit area of a galaxy, decreases with redshift according to 1 over 1 plus z quantity squared if galaxies were pellets zooming through a pre-existing space, but declines as 1 over 1 plus z to the fourth power if it's an actual expansion of space, because there's two more 1 plus z factors that come into the apparent dimming of a galaxy if you go through the mathematics. People have measured this. It's hard to measure because you have to go far enough back in time so that 1 plus z becomes pretty big, but galaxies, you know, evolved with time. There could be, and indeed there was, more star formation in the past, so galaxies were more luminous back then. So people have to take the evolution of galaxies into account. But once they do all that, and it's not even that dependent on their assumptions anymore, nonetheless it's a hard test still, you can see that the data are very close to 1 over 1 plus z to the fourth agreement, and nowhere near 1 over 1 plus z squared. Okay? So that's a good test. There may be others as well, but that's the one I know of. Other questions? I thought I said something. Yeah.
With a lot of weird stuff happening, especially between the realm of quantum mechanics and cosmology, why do we still not question whether laws can be local?
Yeah, so that's a good question. You know, are laws local? Well, we have tests of that. For example, the fine structure constant is E squared over H bar C, okay? And that dictates transitions, electronic transitions in atoms. And you can go and measure, various pairs of absorption or emission lines at high redshift, and you find that the separation in wavelength is the same as it is now, and that means E squared over H by C was the same. So either E and H and C have all changed in such a way to keep their ratio constant, or none of them is changing. Dmitry Butker in this department is actually measuring changes in the fine structure constant in the laboratory by measuring things at the nano or even possibly femtoscale, I'm not sure, femtosecond, like in other words, if things are changing, you can have two possibilities. Either look billions of years ago, or look now in your laboratory, but with billions or sub-billions of a second precision, okay? Even really femto, because, So, and he finds no clear change in the fine structure constant. And there are other similar sorts of things you can do to check whether the laws of physics are changing, or at least the constants are changing. And so far there's been no clear evidence, and you might say, well, this is the evidence, but this would be inconsistent with you know, the fact that we see supernovae exploding in exactly the same way 5 billion years ago. If physics were different at the local scale, the kinds of things you do in laboratories, rather than over the awesomely big scale. Well, I admit, GR may be wrong, okay? So there the laws of physics might be wrong, but the local, everyday laws of mechanics and quantum mechanics and all that, there's just too much evidence that they have not changed. That's something we need to keep in mind. It's a possibility. But there's just no... The dark energy or a failure of GR has been a far more attractive possibility to most physicists than these other things. Nevertheless, let me, you know, since that's such a good question, let me point out that in the case of dark matter, your suggestion definitely has been followed by still a minority of physicists. Nevertheless, there's still a physicist. There's a guy called Milgram in Israel who has a theory called MOND. It's modified Newtonian dynamics. And he effectively says that at accelerations smaller than, I think, 10 or minus 8 or something like that, GMM over D squared does not work. And that there are Rubens, you know, measurements of rotation curves and Fritz Zwicky's, and since then measurements of velocities of galaxies and clusters, don't agree with our expectation, not because there's dark matter there, but because the force law is different at small accelerations, you know. So for dark matter, that's still being pursued. I think it's still very much the case that he's the minority view, in part, not because people are so incredibly rotted. It's, you know, people, the general public often says, oh, you scientists, you're so resistant to change. You don't want a revolution. We're resistant to change because science works well when, you know, we have high standards before we throw ourselves into something headlong. But as I said, Jeff Goodrich in San Diego used to, you know, so you'll never discover anything because you're so set in your ways, the ways of Wall Sargent, my advisor, and other people. I go, Jeff, we propose the acceleration of the universe in dark energy. How can you say we're resistant to change? And now, well, he's died since then, but now nearly everyone accepts it, okay? And he knew even at the time, he only died, you know, a year or two ago or something, you know. And by then, the evidence was very strong. So it's not that we're resistant to change, but the evidence has to be very good. I mean, Sagan said this, you know, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. And the problem with MOND is that it appears to those of us, at least who are not experts, but I have to just believe what the experts tell me, that Milgram has to tune his parameters to explain, on the one hand, the rotation curves of galaxies, on the other hand, the motions of galaxies and clusters of galaxies and so on. In other words, it's not, I mean, he has to fiddle with things. And moreover, and this is perhaps aesthetic, but physics, you know, has been influenced by aesthetics, and correctly so, based on our success over hundreds of years, there's no clear mathematical and conceptual framework for MOND. General relativity depends on one happy thought, Einstein's principle of equivalence, okay? You can't tell the difference between a uniform gravitational field and a uniformly accelerated frame. That's all, other than special relativity, which only depends on two assumptions. You can't tell if you're moving uniformly, and the speed of light is independent of the motion of the source or the observer. Now, that's been experimentally tested. And I just flew in from Washington last night, and, you know, it was a pretty smooth flight over part of it, not so smooth over part of it, and, you know, I ate the usual way and stuff. I mean, I didn't have to take into account that I was moving. So the principles behind special relativity are simple, and the whole thing comes just from that, right? That's the kind of mathematical framework, a beautiful, simple framework that makes relativity such an attractive theory to most physicists, and were very reluctant to give it up, especially when the competitors have a bunch of little knobs they have to keep on turning, okay? But it could turn out that thermodynamics is right. It could be. I just don't think it will. Yeah?
Acceleration happens forever. Does that mean all the degree matter and reach the speed of light?
Definitely the universe speed in the air is expanding faster than the speed of light if you look at objects that are far enough away from each other. And during inflation, that's definitely what happened. We're a bit about to do this. It went like that. And that's because, and this is something very important to know, because you as physicists will be asked this question over and over again from the lay public. They'll say, you can't violate the speed of light. You can when it's the space itself that's expanding. What special relativity says is that no particles, no information, more precisely, can travel through a pre-existing space faster than the speed of light. But let's say I take two ping-pong balls that were originally more than 300,000 kilometers from each other, and let's say I set things up so that at noon, and I can synchronize all these clocks, all the pieces of rubber, you know, each centimeter expands into two. You know, that can happen. I can set things up that way, right? Then two ping-pong balls that were separated by more than 300,000 kilometers, in 1 second, they're suddenly separated by more than 600,000 kilometers. In other words, they receded from one another at more than the speed of light. That's okay, because it was just the cumulative effect of a whole bunch of little centimeters doubling. Okay? One ping-pong ball can't use the expansion of the universe to send any information to the other one. Indeed, the very fact that space is expanding faster than the speed of light prohibits this ping-pong ball from communicating with the other one. So yes, in an inflating universe, it's very easy. In fact, it's necessary. This is in a sense why we've dreamed it up, right? You have a causally connected little tiny blob where it all came into a uniform temperature, all right? And it goes whoosh. It expands and cools, but it cools uniformly everywhere because the expansion was uniform, driven by whatever stuff was there, and then it just kept on recreating itself, or who knows, this is where, you know, that's above my pay grade, right? I know which end of the telescope to look through, okay? I don't know all this theory of mumbo jumbo, but this is what the people tell me, but somehow they get these inflating models to inflate, and the uniformity, the homogeneity that was established in a small causally connected region, then gets transformed into a homogeneity over a universe that's way, way bigger than the normal distance that light could have traveled. That's the problem with the standard Big Bang, is it's too big to have reached this homogeneity, because it was always bigger than the distance light could have traveled. In fact, it becomes worse and worse with time, as you go back in time, at least in the decelerating universe. Back at the time of microwave background radiation picture, the causally connected regions were, as viewed by us, only about a degree in size at the time. So that map is like thousands of causally disconnected regions, yet they're all at the same temperature, other than these tiny little fluctuations. But other than that, it's all at 3 degrees Kelvin to our partner in 100,000. There's no way to understand that in the standard Big Bang model. The way to get it is with superluminal expansion. Okay? Yeah. Very cool. Huh? Yes? Mm-hmm.
Could more SN1A observations help us distinguish between an exponentially expanding universe and a big rip?
So what's being mentioned here is, well, first of all, let me just first say, I know what you mean, but we're not yet exponentiating because the dark energy doesn't completely dominate over dark matter. So we're accelerating as the slices of the pile, which change with time, by the way, because there's particles in a box, and as the box expands, the matter density goes down. But this stuff remains roughly constant. That means as a fraction of the total pie, this stuff is increasing with time. So as it gets closer to 100%, yes, we will enter an exponential phase. Now, what's your name?
Christian.
Christian is asking about is what's called the big rip. Some people call it the big chill. It's a universe that runs away and expands forever, but galaxies and clusters of galaxies remain bound because the the density, the energy density of this repulsive stuff is not changing with time. And if galaxies are bound now, they'll remain bound forever. But what Christiana is referring to is that what if you have an energy density that grows with time? Then eventually clusters of galaxies will get ripped apart, then galaxies, then solar systems, then planets, and even atoms of which you're made, technically, would get ripped apart. That's the big rip. So, that's a possibility. In fact, the beta are not yet inconsistent with it. It's a type of energy whose density is growing with time, and you know, what we can tell right now is that the beta are consistent with being unchanging with time, but we haven't yet ruled out that it's not changing with time, so it could be. It's a very weird kind of energy. Theorists don't like it at all. It violates the thing known as the weak energy condition, I think it is, or is it the strong energy condition that it violates? Whatever. It sort of violates energy conservation in some weird way. Nevertheless, we've not tested the laws of physics to rule that out. It's kind of like coiled steady state theory. You could say, well, it required, you know, atoms to come out of nowhere. Well, yeah, at the rate of one hydrogen atom, I think I calculated once, per cubic meter per billion years. Would you notice if at some day, you know, someday an extra atom suddenly appeared in here? No. In other words, the steady state theory of Hoyle was wrong not because of conservation of energy, because we've never measured conservation of energy to that degree of precision. It was wrong because we later found that galaxies evolve, the universe evolved, blah, blah, blah. There's the microwave background radiation, there's the primordial nucleosynthesis. The Big Bang is correct. Nevertheless, Hoyle stimulated a lot of important thought. But people who dismiss the steady state for reasons of conservation of energy are incorrect, okay? We like conservation of energy, but we've not proven it. In a similar way, this kind of weird energy violates things we like, but they're not God-given, right? They're not written in stone somewhere, right? So yes, we should, if we live long enough, get the measurements to good enough precision to see what this thing is, and among the experts, everyone talks about W. Now, W is sort of the English version of omega, right? But we're not talking about omega matter or anything. We're talking about a thing called the equation of state parameter. And it's -1 for the cosmological constant. The density of the universe goes as the scale factor R to the -3 times the quantity 1 plus W. So if W is -1, 1 plus -1 is 0, R to the 0 power is 1. So the density of the universe of this weird stuff doesn't change. If W is less than -1, then it's this phantom energy. People don't like that. But we do not yet know whether it's not true. Yes?
Like, if you said that there's a possibility that this dark energy effect can change sign,
yeah,
and that it, like, kind of depends on the density of the universe and the distance between stuff, wouldn't there be a chance, like, I mean, if you change sign and it starts to be attractive, and then maybe change sign.
Maybe change sign again.
And
right.
Could it be, like, possible that the universe would be oscillating?
Yeah, the oscillating universe has been sort of philosophically attractive to a number of people and even cultures, right? Buddhist culture. In Buddhism, the sort of reincarnating oscillating universe is, I believe, a sort of fundamental idea. There's no evidence for it, of course. So, since we don't know what the dark energy is, pretty much anything goes. Now, my theoretical friends would say, well, that's not completely fair, right? You know, there are certain plausibility arguments that things are either one way or another. Nevertheless, we really don't know what the dark energy is, so I repeat, anything goes, okay? So yes, it's possible, but I don't bet on it, okay? And moreover, even if the stuff changes sign, you know, the motion, the outward motion is already there and will continue for quite a while. So it's not going to stop and reverse itself anytime soon. Some of my colleagues have made calculations that the soonest that there could be a big crunch is something like 50 billion years or maybe 100 billion. And that's if the stuff became attractive right now. But, you know, it would keep coasting for a while. It's just like after inflation, the so-called inflaton, which is what the theorists call their version of dark energy, the thing that inflated the universe, the inflaton decayed into attractive stuff. But, all right, that stopped the exponentiation, that stopped the launching. But the universe kept on expanding, and, you know, it started slowing down gradually. And it would have been quite a while before it turns around, depending on exactly what omega is. And omega is 1 plus or minus 0.01 or 0.02. So it's not much different from 1. And that means even if it is a bit bigger than 1, it's not like the thing is going to go like that. I mean, it's like only barely wants to slow down to a stop and then turn around. It's almost like an apple thrown at the escape speed. I mean, it's like an apple thrown almost at the escape speed. I had the almost in the wrong place, right? An apple thrown at almost the escape speed is going to get to the Andromeda Galaxy before it turns around. And you have to, of course, ignore the gravity of the Andromeda Galaxy because it would get sucked in there, but you know what I mean. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
How confident are you that antimatter has negative gravity?
Yeah, so all the theoretical work suggests that antimatter has negative gravity, has positive gravity.
Well, because they're doing measurements now with
antihydrogen. I think these, either I said it wrong, you said it wrong, one of us said it wrong, but whatever. Antimatter has positive attractive gravity. Now, that's never been measured, I think, because the gravitational attraction between two hydrogen atoms, it's just too weak. Gee, it's like, way weak, you know. And the Cavendish experiment was very hard to do. G, not only the fourth significant digits, is by far the least well-known constant in physics. I think, you know, C of Y is now a defined quantity, in fact. H bar is known very well. E is known unbelievably well because electric fields are so strong and stuff. But G is only known for 4 digits. So we actually don't know experimentally that it's positive gravity. However, antimatter can be produced by collisions of regular particles, okay? And those are positive mass, right? I mean, anti-gravity would really have to correspond to negative energy, negative mass. And so the arithmetic doesn't work out. That counting doesn't work out unless antimatter has positive attractive gravity. And antimatter pairs form out of photons. Photons can form out of nuclear reactions, E equals mc squared. Since the photons are positive energy and are gravitationally attractive, although that too, we've never measured the gravitational attraction of a photon, but it's not doubted for a moment. It's the same kind of mathematical and physical reasoning that leads to antimatter being positive gravity as well, attractive gravity. Okay? It comes from photons, it's positron electron pairs, and that photon has attractive gravity. So to make the math, it's just 2 plus a negative 2. That negative 2, the antimatter, still has to be a positive mass, a positive energy density with the normal gravitational attraction. But it's not been measured, it's just an outcome of things we think we know. But I think there is an experiment. I heard about this. Someone sent this to me. How are they going about measuring the gravitational attraction of a...
Well, they're getting enough
hydrogen
they're producing.
Enough in a ball. Like a Cavendish ball almost, but
yeah.
Anyway, I mean, yeah, so, you know, we shouldn't take it for granted. I'm glad people are trying to measure it, but it's one of these almost thankless jobs, right? If they measure it to be true, people will say, so what? If they measure it to not be true, people won't believe them. Nevertheless, when you go and do gutsy experiments like this, there's the potential for an unanticipated discovery. I must admit, even 20 years ago, I said, yeah, this is an exciting project. We want to measure the expansion history of the universe. But I said, you know, we're going to find that omega is 0.3 or something. And other people said, well, what if the theorists are right and we find that it's 1? It's okay. That'd be kind of cool. And that's why I'm excited about this. But I said, we're going to find one of the expected answers. And you know what? We didn't. And that's what's made it, you know, way, way exciting. And we only measured something, one of the expected answers. Great. I mean, I was always excited by the project, but part of me a little bit said, you know, So what? You know, we're not going to be Newtons or Einsteins or people who completely change the conceptual framework of our physical understanding of the universe, right? We would find one of the expected results. And if it's one, then you don't know what you've got, because you don't know whether it's one plus epsilon or one minus epsilon. And if you go back to those curves I showed, you know, the difference between a universe that eventually collapses and a universe that expands forever is just epsilon. It's this one here. Sorry. Right? Which side of... Oh, shoot, I got to go pick up my kids. We're in preschool. Which side of this line are they close at? 6, 539. Which side of the line you're on determines in a normal matter universe whether you eventually collapse or expand forever. So my ruling was, the field is so light, omega matter is 1, but we won't know which side of one it's on, because that's too hard a measurement to make. You know, we'll never know. Indeed, I think we'll never know if it really is one, because of what's called cosmic variance. We see only one small fraction of the whole universe. Just like this room has some average density for the molecules, some number per cubic centimeter, most of the individual cubic centimeters have a number that's either above average or below average. So measuring only one of them doesn't actually tell you which side of the average density you're on. You see that? Right? This is called cosmic variance. The universe is thought to be way bigger than what we can see, but the part we can see, though we think is broadly representative, you know, we might be way out on the tail, then we're really unlucky, but suppose we're right near the peak. Most people are near average, but are on one side or the other, right? That's the problem.